Hello, it's my pleasure to welcome you today to Susan G. Komen's virtual MBC Impact Series event. I'm Casey Volpe with Susan G. Komen's Community Education and Outreach team. The programming for this series is envisioned as a year-long conversation with attendees, presenting new information and speakers each month. Today, our important conversation will focus on bone metastases and potential treatments. Our featured speaker addressing questions is Dr. Rebecca Waters from Natera Inc. Please remember our speakers are not able to provide individual medical advice, so do your best to keep questions as general as possible. Before we begin, Komen would like to thank our sponsors for supporting the 2022 MBC Impact Series. Thank you to AstraZeneca for being the technology sponsor for this year's event series. This virtual setting means that MBC patients, no matter where they live, can be a part of this community. We would also like to thank our premier sponsor, Amgen, and our signature sponsors, Walgreens, DSI, and Sanofi. The series is made possible because of the generosity of these sponsors. One more housekeeping note. While our speaker is talking, please feel free to post your questions in the Q&A feature in Zoom. We will get to as many as we can. Toward the end of our programming, a survey link will be placed in the chat. Your feedback is very important to us and helpful for future MBC program planning. And by completing the survey, you'll be entered into a drawing to win an Amazon gift card. Now, we are excited you all are joining us for today's discussion. I would like to introduce you to Dr. Rebecca Waters, today's speaker. Dr. Waters is a medical science liaison on the breast oncology team at Natera. She has her doctorate in molecular biology from the Pennsylvania State University and an executive MBA with a focus in healthcare from the University of Pittsburgh. Previously, she was an assistant professor in the Department of Orthopedic Surgery at the University of Pittsburgh School of Medicine. She served as the associate director for the Pittsburgh Center for Bone and Mineral Research and the co-director of the Musculoskeletal Oncology Laboratory. Her research was focused on investigating novel therapeutic targets for breast cancer bone metastases. Dr. Waters, the floor is yours.
Okay. Casey, thank you so much for that kind introduction, and I'm incredibly honored to be here today. I want to thank the organizers and Susan G. Komen for inviting me. Okay. So let's go ahead and get started. Okay, so just some disclosures to begin with. I am an employee and shareholder of Natera. The opinions and views I express today are personally my own and not of my company's. And I am not a clinician, I'm not a medical doctor, so therefore I cannot provide any medical advice or discuss your treatment regimens. And I'm here on a volunteer basis as a past Komen-funded researcher. Okay. So just to begin with some basic stats that I think maybe a lot of you on the call know, but breast cancer is the leading cancer for estimated new cases in women in the country. And it's the second leading cause for deaths, followed right by lung. As most people know, for women, the lifetime risk of being diagnosed with breast cancer is about 1 in 8. But also for men, the risk for developing breast cancer is about 1 in 833. So at this particular point in time, for most cancers across the board, and especially breast, we're really good at dealing with localized disease. Often surgery, chemo regimens, endocrine therapy regimens, you know, can do a really great job with handling the primary tumor. And the overall five-year survival rate for disease, if it's caught at the localized state, is pretty good. It's almost around 99%. And so if you look, this has remained relatively constant from 2005 to 2015. However, the issue is when you start to get into metastatic disease. So metastatic disease is really largely uncharacterized still. You know, up until recently, all breast cancer research, maybe 7% of funding was actually going towards metastatic breast cancer research, which is incredibly frustrating for the individuals that are living with it, but also for the people that are trying to develop cures and therapies. And so, as you can see here, if we focus specifically on breast, we can see this has really remained largely unchanged in the distant metastatic disease setting. So this is super important because we know that metastases will end up occurring in about 30% of breast cancer patients. So currently, we believe there are about 3.4 million Americans living with breast cancer. Bone is the most frequent site. It will occur in about 3/4 of these patients. And at this particular point in time, our current treatments really don't prevent new bone metastases from occurring. And over 3/4 of these women will suffer, and men will suffer a metastatic recurrence. And at this particular point in time, the greatest obstacle for better care for patients living with metastatic breast cancer to bone is really our poor understanding of metastatic disease. And there are really three areas specifically that need more work. So one being this unmet need for novel therapeutic targets, better diagnosis to try to predict therapy response early and maybe even detection earlier, and also really a lack of focus on quality of life and the significant financial toxicity that comes along with having metastatic breast cancer. A lot of people don't think about this until they've gone through it or had a loved one go through this. So trying to understand metastatic disease, and this is a quote that was originally from Dr. Stephen Paget, published this in The Lancet in 1889, and he was really one of the ones to kind of first coin this. So if you think about a cancer cell as a seed, so kind of liken this to a plant. When a plant goes to seed, its seeds are carried in all directions, but they can only live and grow if they fall in congenial soil. So if you think about this in the case of bone, so you know, when we think about different types of cancer, when they disseminate and spread throughout the body, they're going to look for the soil that is most beneficial for them to grow. So I like this diagram here because it shows you different types of cancer and where they like to go in the body. So if you look at brain, lung, breast, melanoma, renal, and colorectal, they like to go to brain. Same for lung. Sarcomas, almost all sarcomas always go to lung. And then if you look in the case of colorectal, pancreatic, breast, lung, stomach, they love to go to liver. But specifically for bone, we've got breast, lung, prostate, renal cell, and colorectal, and sometimes on rare occasion, ovarian. So bone metastases are a major public health issue. They result in intense pain. This is due to increased pathological fractures. You can have hypercalcemia. This is increased calcium levels in the blood and nerve compression, which is a result of some of these pathological bone fractures because of the cancer cells in the bone weakening it, which we'll get into in a moment. And at this particular time, the Metastatic Breast Cancer Alliance put out a report in about 2017 where they thought there were about over 150,000 documented to be living with stage four disease, although we believe these numbers to be much greater. It's just hard to find those accurate records. And as I mentioned previously, over three quarters of these patients will end up developing bone metastases. And the unfortunate news currently at this time, which we're hoping to change, only 27% of these particular patients will survive beyond 5 years. So if we look about at this and we try to decide, okay, well, we've got, you know, breast cancer isn't just one kind of disease, right? There's different subtypes involved, right? And some of you on the call might have a hormonal receptor positive tumor or HER2 positive or triple positive, or some might even be triple negative or have triple negative tumors. At this point in time, we kind of been able to do some research and figure out what particular subtype of tumors like to go to bone versus other organs. And it's always overwhelmingly hormone receptor positive tumors love to go to the bone. And so is it because maybe there's a hormonal component in the bone? There's a lot of research trying to figure out why. Why is it that these hormonal subtypes love to go to bone? Whereas if you think about, you know, HER2 positive, they like to go to the brain, and triple negative breast cancers tend to go more to the visceral organs like lung and liver. And so one of the good pieces of news is patients that had initial bone metastasis had a better five-year survival rate compared to those with initial brain, liver, or lung metastasis. So how does the seed arrive at the soil? How does this cancer cell find the bone in the first place? So, you know, it's kind of confusing when you start thinking about all the different processes involved, but I like this picture because I think it simplifies it nicely. I'm going to go ahead and put my pointer on here. So if you think about it, you think about the original organ, the breast. So the breast has ducts through it. And when you start having these cancer cells develop within that duct, we call it the lumen, the open space of that duct, they start to crawl out of the duct and into the surrounding breast tissue. From there, they can actually catch a ride in any surrounding vessels, or they can even secrete factors to have blood vessels rerouted to them so that they can enter that bloodstream. So those cancer cells will we call it intravasation. They will enter that bloodstream, and a lot of them end up dying actually in circulation, but there's always a few that make it. So they end up hitching a ride through the circulatory system and then landing in the bone. And how they get there is they actually extravasate from the vessels into the surrounding bone tissue, and they can take up residence. And this is one of the scary things is that, you know, when you have these cells, so we call them disseminated tumor cells, when they get to the bone, they can remain there quiescent, and so completely quiet, not actively proliferating or dying, just in a static state, and they can live there for a very long time, which is why you might end up sometimes seeing bone metastases recurring in a patient maybe 10, 15 years down the road from their initial diagnosis. And so we're trying to understand now, and a lot of research is going into this, what makes these cells suddenly start proliferating? What makes them start growing? What signals are there? What stressors make them suddenly start growing out into these overt metastases? And so what they end up doing is they end up colonizing that bone. And so in order to understand how bone metastases work, you really need to first think about normal bone maintenance. So in the normal bone, you typically have this healthy honeycomb-like structure. So you've got this collagen scaffold, and it's filled with mineral to help strengthen it. And most people, when they think about bone, they think of this static, non-living system. It's very much alive. It's where all your immune cells come from, your bone marrow is there. It's very active. And it's not just this static structure that doesn't have anything going on. And actually, there are two bone cell types that are super important. One are your osteoblasts. So blasts build bone, they lay down matrix. And then you have your osteoclast. These are really interesting cells. And I think that, you know, when I was doing my research, I always thought these were the most cool cell in the body because they're multinucleated, they're gigantic. They've got this ruffled border where they secrete acid to resorb the bone. So this is occurring in normal bone. And so that resorption, that balance between your osteoclasts and your osteoblasts that build bone, generally that's in an equilibrium. So that's in a healthy, normal bone, and especially in younger people. Now, as you can see, when you start to age, these openings start to get bigger. And that's because as you start to age, certain factors start to occur. You start to have less estrogen. Estrogen is very important for bone. And so you start to have more resorption and less bone formation. This can make individuals prone to osteoporosis and also lead to fractures. So you can see how it's just this delicate balance between blasts that build and osteoclasts that resorb or break down. And this remodeling, this is normal because you have small stress fractures or things throughout whatever you end up doing, and your bone is there. Your bone cells are there to constantly remodel and make sure that it's healthy and it's strong. So that's a normal thing to have these cells. So don't think because you have osteoblasts or osteoclasts in your bone, it's a bad thing. It's actually a good thing, and they're generally in a nice equilibrium with each other. However, if you look at this diagram, and it looks a little busy at first, but I'm going to walk you through it. When cancer cells come into play, it's what we call this vicious cycle in bone, because these cancer cells have figured out a way to hijack the osteoclast and cause them to have more resorption. So we talked about this. You have your osteoblast cells aligned on the bone here. They're laying down this mineral matrix, trying to strengthen your bone. Then you've got your osteoclasts that are resorbing or fixing any areas. And then what happens is your cancer cells come in, and they start secreting all these kinds of factors. So these factors end up getting your osteoclast to go into overdrive. So what happens is you've got these precursors for osteoclasts. It starts secreting these things that cause the osteoclast to start producing more. So suddenly that really nice balance between your blasts that are building and your clasts that are breaking down, it's completely out of whack. You suddenly have these more osteoclasts, and they're resorbing way more than your osteoblast can actually lay down matrix. And the breast cancer cells are pretty devious because they can also secrete factors that will inhibit osteoblast precursors, these cells, from becoming mature osteoblasts. So they're not able to lay down more bone. And so, as you can see, this is what we call that vicious cycle, because it ends up getting worse. Your osteoclasts go into overdrive, and then you have less osteoblasts to be able to compensate for that. And I actually put this little QR code here on the right, if you wanted to scan that and check it out. These are actually 10-year-old videos from Amgen, but I remember, you know, back in my early postdoc days and when I would teach or when I would talk with anybody who wanted to know more, I always like to use these videos as a resource because they just have a really nice, elegant, and simple animation of what happens when those cancer cells go to the bone, if you want to see kind of in real time what might be happening. So how do these bone metastases tend to present within the body? So there's three different types you can actually end up with. So you can end up with the lytic. So I've tried to put some arrows here in labels so that you kind of understand where this is being oriented in the body. So this would be in someone's vertebrae, and this is a CT scan. Maybe some of you have had this, so you're familiar with the CT scan. It's X-ray. And so you're looking at it and the bone actually shows up as kind of like this white substance. And so in a normal vertebral body, you would expect this to be nice and white and all filled in. However, when you got those osteoclasts going into overdrive and they're resorbing that bone, you can see it's starting to eat it away. And so that's what we call lytic. And so this is an issue because, as you can imagine, as it's eating away at the bone and you're not building new bone, that weakens your bone and you become more prone to potential fracture. This can also result in spinal cord compression relating from these fractures and also hypercalcemia, because as those osteoclasts start to resorb the bone, they release calcium. And so you end up with more calcium in your blood, which is not necessarily a good thing if you have too much. Another thing I wanted to mention, when they resorb the bone, they're releasing other growth factors too. So the cancer cells actually pick up those growth factors and start to proliferate even more. And so another form of type of metastasis you could have in the bone is also blastic. It's interesting because it's the opposite effect. In this case, your osteoblasts are kind of going into overdrive. And we actually see this more in cancers like osteosarcomas, which are primary cancers that originate in the bone, versus breast cancer, which goes to the bone. But you can see now there's more white, right? So this is a pelvis here. So you can see these little white, almost looks like little white golf balls. Suddenly, these are blastic tumors forming. So you've got the opposite problem. You've got more bone being laid down. And you would probably ask, well, isn't that better than a lytic metastasis? Not necessarily, because the bone it's laying down is not good quality lamellar bone. It's this woven bone with lots of pores. So again, same issue. You become more prone to fractures. And then you can also have an interesting case where you have it mixed, both lytic and blastic. And then over here in this panel, panel E, this is an example of a whole bone scan. So this is something they might do. This uses a radioisotope tracer, and you can look to see if there's widespread skeletal disease. And a lot of the times, this is usually the case with bone metastases. It tends to spread throughout the skeleton because the bone marrow is all connected through your bones. And you can see anything that shows up dark here, that's actually cancer. So you can see it in the person's spine, their pelvis, and their shoulder. So this person has widespread metastatic disease in the bone. And then down here in panel F, this is another image they might type of imaging they might do for you. It's called FDG PET. And so really this is looking for cells that are metabolically active. So what does that mean? Cells that are actively proliferating. So they'll take up this marker and show up as these kind of these hot orange spots or red spots on the scan. And so one of the things about all of these imaging modalities is they can pick up bone metastases when they've become overt. When they've, you know, gone from a small cluster of cells. Unfortunately, none of these imaging modalities can pick up small clusters of disseminated tumor cells. So that's really where we need to work on more sensitive methods of detection earlier on before they become these overt metastatic tumors. And so currently right now, there are various approved therapeutic agents. And so you may have already heard of some of these, but I just want to go through them again because this is what most medical oncologists in your team. So you're probably being treated by a multidisciplinary team. So you probably have musculoskeletal radiologists, interventional radiologists, orthopedic surgeons, endocrinologists. So really when you get to that metastatic disease state, you've got a whole multidisciplinary team to help care for you. And so one of the particular things they might do are radiation therapy. So radiation therapy can actually help with the pain and prevent risk of fractures. So they'll use something like external beam radiation to try to focus in on those actively dividing tumors in the bone. They might also use something like radiopharmaceuticals. And then also surgery. So surgery is with orthopedic surgeons. So you might end up going to an orthopedic surgeon if your oncologist happens to see on a scan that your bone looks pretty weak. They're worried that you might have an impending pathological fracture, or unfortunately, there's been instances where the tumor has weakened the bone so much that you end up fracturing it and you have to go immediately to the orthopedic surgeon to have this taken care of. So some of the things they might do is curettage. So they actually have a tool that they can go in and scrape out that tumor. And then they'll stabilize it with a rod, pins, or screws. They also have other stabilizers like bone cement that they can use to kind of fill in those holes to help stabilize the bones. And then some of the more common agents are bone targeting agents. So these are two really big classes. So you've got your bisphosphonates and then you've got denosumab. So bisphosphonates, some of these might look familiar if you're on these. So you've got Actonel, Fosamax, Boniva, Reclass, Aridia. Some of these are given intravenously. Some can be given orally or both ways. And so really the point of how bisphosphonates work is that they've got phosphate groups on them. And when you put them in the body, they actually can attach to the mineral on the surface of the bone. So if you look in this image here, where it says BP, that's indicating a bisphosphonate where it's bound to the bone. So when the osteoclast comes along, because you've got all these active osteoclasts now because of the cancer cells sending them into overdrive, they kind of come along the bone and they take up this bisphosphonate. This bisphosphonate, when it gets taken up into the osteoclast, actually disrupts its whole ability to have that ruffled border to be able to secrete the acid that it needs to resorb that bone. So it essentially stops the osteoclast in its tracks and also can cause osteoclast death as well. And so they're effective in that way. And then you also have denosumab. So anytime you see a drug with mab at the end, that means monoclonal antibody. And so the way denosumab works is it's kind of modeled after something that we know as osteoprotegerin. So that's something that normally osteoblasts would secrete to try to block a factor called RANK ligand. So RANK ligand is something that will bind to osteoclasts and activate them. So this particular monoclonal antibody, denosumab, will bind to that RANK ligand and prevent it from getting to the osteoclast. So it prevents that osteoclast activation, as you can see in this image right here. So you can see the denosumab monoclonal antibody is indicated here by this little green figure, binding to that RANK ligand and not allowing it to get to the receptor on the osteoclast. So you never end up with these active osteoclasts. And so both of these methods have been effective in limiting that osteoclast activity, helping with any bone-related pain. So some of the other things that you can do for bone health support in addition to these various treatment regimens. And so as I go through this list, one thing I really want to tell you is before you do anything with your diet and your exercise, always, always, always consult your physician to make sure that you're healthy enough to take on certain new activities or make any changes in your diet. But this goes without saying, maintaining a healthy weight. Maintaining a healthy weight reduces inflammation and other factors. It also relieves some of the pressure on your joints and on your bones if you weigh less. Eating a diet rich in calcium and vitamin D. So it's no secret that a stronger bone is going to be able to withstand any kind of active resorption. So if you have strong, healthy bones to begin with, you're going to be in a better place than for someone who hasn't been taking care of their bones. Performing something like weight-bearing exercises. So in order to have stronger bones, you need to bear weight on them. And so what does this mean? Simple things like walking, taking the stairs, jogging, dancing. You know, these things help with weight-bearing, these weight-bearing exercises help you to build stronger bones. And so again, these are things that you'd want to talk with your doctor about before going and doing. And these particular items here, if your provider hasn't already mentioned this to you, Avoiding smoking and limiting alcohol use will do wonders to be able to help protect your bone. And if you have any issues with balance, or if you're elderly, minimize your risk of falls, right? Clear the paths that you take in your house, clear out any rugs or anything you might trip over, because if you fall and break a bone, this is obviously going to set back your treatment, and this is going to affect your remodeling too in that area where you broke the bone. And you're going to have to go for surgery, you're going to have longer recovery time. So I know some of these things sound simple, and for other people, they think, wow, that seems like a lot to have to do. But I know from talking with patient advocates and having family members and friends that have gone through this cancer journey themselves, generally you're always looking for whatever you can do, any little thing you could do to try to make a difference in your outcome. These might be things that you could control, that you could try to use to help your outcome. And these are things that you'd want to talk with your oncologist about. And so eating a diet rich in calcium and vitamin D are super important because, again, as I mentioned, calcium builds strong bones, but vitamin D helps with that resorption. So that's one of the things you'd want to talk about with your provider. If you're not getting enough from your diet, what could you do for supplementation? One of the other things I really want to stress about this, any kind of drugs or supplements you're taking, keep a list with you. Always bring that up with your providers when you're meeting with them, so that they know, so that they can keep your records up to date. If you're being seen by different providers in different systems, or you're going to different pharmacies, people might not catch all of your latest drugs or previous drugs that you were on, but they haven't removed them from your record. Always, always take an updated list of your medications with you and any supplements that you might be taking. It's incredibly important so that they know, you know, any reactions or side effects you might be having, they can figure that out early, how to correct that. And I put this QR code here, so if you wanted to read up a bit more about bone health and what you can do to kind of help support that, you can go to this site here, the Surgeon General's Report on Bone Health. Okay. And so with that, I'd just like to thank you all again for letting me be here, and I'm happy to take any questions. But I also want to, make mention of this amazing individual, Daniel Garcia. Daniel was my patient advocate mentor that I worked with for over 4 years. Daniel helped me on all my public abstracts. He helped me understand how my research could be having impact in the field. But sadly, we lost Daniel last May to metastatic breast cancer. And so anytime I talk about bone metastases and metastatic breast cancer, I always like to think of him. And I like to share his story with everyone as a reminder that men can get breast cancer. They do get breast cancer. And just to remember, the important impact that the patient voice can have in research. So thank you all so much. And I will go ahead and stop sharing my screen, and I'm happy to take any questions.
All right, Dr. Waters, the first question, how often do you suggest having bone density scans?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so bone density scans, so thinking about DEXA scans, I think generally they recommend those about every 2 years. But again, check with your provider. But typically, it's about every 2 years.
Okay, thank you for that.
Yeah.
We don't have any more questions currently coming in, but I just wanted to give it a quick minute in case somebody's typing.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's sweet. Thank you, Deborah. Yeah, and one thing I might want to just comment on here too, because you might be wondering, well, where are future directions heading? So, there's a lot of interest. A lot of researchers are looking at these disseminated tumor cells, or these cells that can lay dormant in the bone for many years. Some people and groups are trying to work on ways to figure out how to wake up those cells, because those cells, they're not actively dividing. Chemo's not going to get them. Our current treatments aren't going to be able to target a lot of non-actively dividing cells, and also they're not going to be picked up on scans. So some people are trying to think of ways to maybe wake them up to make them more susceptible to treatments, and then other people are trying to find ways to detect them earlier so that we can develop therapies to target them before they would wake up. So it's interesting. There's different ways people are trying to, hone in on that early before you end up having issues with bone metastases down the road. Okay.
Well, we were very excited that you all could join us today for this very important event. We want to express our gratitude to our speaker today, Dr. Rebecca Waters. Today's session was recorded and will be posted on the landing page soon, so you can log in and rewatch this session or watch previous sessions you may have missed. Please help us spread the word about this important content with your friends, family, and healthcare professionals you think may be interested. Once again, we want to acknowledge our sponsors of the 2022 MBC Impact Series. Their generous support allows us to continue to bring this community together to share important information, resources, and experiences. A very special thank you to AstraZeneca for being the technology sponsor for this year's series. We would also like to thank our premier sponsor, Amgen, and our signature sponsors, Walgreens, Sanofi, and DSI. This series is made possible because of the generosity of these sponsors. Please also help us by completing a survey, which you can now find in the chat feature of the platform. Your feedback is very important to us and helpful for future MBC program planning. And by completing the survey, you will be entered into a drawing to win an Amazon gift card. Finally, the next event in the MBC Impact Series will be in July, and the focus of that conversation will be financial toxicity. We look forward to having you log in and join the conversation. Thank you again for joining us today, and thank you to all who made this event possible. Stay safe, stay connected.